worried about maintaining the standards. So he is the man, probably our interaction is for last 5 years now, and he will be talking about how do I go about accreditation of the hospital.
Thank you, Dr. Raji. Thanks for the opportunity. So as a young practitioner or ophthalmologist after PG, you enter your practice, either academic practice or your own practice, and then try to start a career. And this is where technical competencies will get you the second rung of the leadership, towards the leadership. And once you develop these leadership skills, that were the financial skills like Dr. Devashish, or the experience of leading a team, you get to the third position. But when you want to reach the excellence in healthcare delivery, high care delivery, you need some sort of certification. The peer review, in journals they call it as peer review journal. So that indicates your peers accept your paper as the best one or in the top of the club. Similarly, if your practice has to reach the excellence, you need to attain certain position based on not only on your professional competency, not only on your technical competency as a surgeon, also your leadership skills. And the way you, the Harvard Business Review has established accreditation as the single most important approach to improving the quality of healthcare in hospitals. So the initial, how to start with is, you establish quality systems in your practice. It need not be a big practice, like 10 hospitals of Disha Group or 16 hospitals of CFS. So even in your single man practice, you can establish system. Anyway, you need 2 or 3 people to help you. With that 2 or 3 people, technicians or optometrists, if you establish certain norms in your practice, the basic things you do when seeing patients, that is establishing quality system. Then you can go for healthcare accreditation. Once that is established and you establish your practice with a few more people in your practice or a few more consultants in your practice, when it becomes more than 2 consultants and more than 5 or 6 people, definitely you need some system to be to establish in your practice. So then comes the question of accreditation. Maybe a simple ISO accreditation, or it could be country-specific accreditation like NABH, or international accreditation like JCI. And once you achieve this, you practice certain quality indicators and quality system and achieve the service accreditation excellence. That's why Harvard says that is the best way to achieve excellence in your practice. So what is this accreditation? So it is a self-assessment and peer assessment. It's not only the peer assessment, you have your own self-assessment before going for this accreditation, used by hospitals to assess their level of performance in relation to a health standard. It's not the standard written by yourself, but this is by established standard. So there are various standards, one is the ISO, that's easy for single hospitals. Another one is the NABH small hospital standard. And even now in NABH we have come with small clinic norms, which is therefore, smaller clinics where even one doctor clinics can approach NABH for certification, and then implement ways to continuously improve it. So if this becomes very complex, I'll simplify it for you. So this is based on written and published standards, and the reviews are conducted by professional peers. If it is your ophthalmology or ophthalmic setup, the review is conducted by ophthalmologist, and it is administered by an independent body. Unlike government bodies, which are known for bias and other activities, here it is administered by an independent body. And the aim of this certification or accreditation is to encourage your own professional growth and organizational development or hospital development. So how it really helps? So if you take healthcare in a even in a small hospital, it is a bit complex process. So what you know as a clinician is, patient comes to your setup, you see the patient, give them prescription, they go out. But how the patient processes, they have to take auto, come to your setup and give the known, then the registration process, then they have to wait to see optometrist, then optometrist does something, then he puts a dilatation drops or some other drops without his knowledge. He has to wait another 1 hour and then sees the clinician. He tells up investigations, then the investigation is done by somebody else. So it becomes a long process. Further, the hospital looks like a maze. So what accreditation does it? It simplifies them into different small processes where the patient understands the system in a better way. So the separate technique to improve quality is reduce the risk. Automatically the quality goes up. So how do we do this? So there are certain few factors. So instead of this telling the 100 NABH standards, I have simplified into the few important risk reduction factors. So we all know, as you age, maybe in, for youngsters, memory would be good. For aged people like us, memory will be failing. And reduce that reliance on memory. So what you do is start documenting. So once you document, it becomes easy for many other people. So if there are too many people in your systems and processes, documenting really helps. So it's easy for them. And reduce the steps. So as I said earlier, patient coming to a hospital, coming through various systems, if you can reduce by 50%, you are simplifying the processes. To standardize or uniform process. So if there are 3 or 4 doctors, to see to that those doctors follow the same norms and use protocols and checklists. This is how airline industry have improved the safety margin. You take many of the world standard airline industry, they use this checklist system to improve their safety to 99.99%. So we can also copy from the airline industry and follow this checklist system to improve the safety in our hospitals. And you need to recognize fatigue effect. So you have to optimize work, don't give 12 hours work for staff. Recognize the fatigue effect. You need to provide education and training of your practice and promote teamwork. Like what the Disha group have done, they've done a consistent education and training for the consultants and also promote teamwork. And that's how the group practice came into. And reduce known source of confusion. If there are some sources of confusion, try to reduce that. So how do you go about this accreditation? You need to know these standards, interpret them, and then implement them. So there are certain elements of these standards. So these are nothing but you are stating something. I'll try to make it very simple. It's a statement of a desired and achievable level of performance against which actual performance can be measured. Okay. So I have just grouped into certain policies and protocols. So this is the main standard. Policies and procedures guiding the care of patient undergoing surgery. Suppose you are going to operate on the patients. All the policies for surgery would be documented, and that includes the list of surgical procedures that you will do. So if you are trained for cataract, then you will do only cataract related procedures. And all these patients will undergo a standard assessment process after the diagnosis, and that should be documented. And both preoperative and provisional diagnosis, when they are documented, that become legally clear framework. And informed consent is obtained by the surgeon. This is a legal requirement, but when you start practicing, that becomes easier. And over a period of time, that will really help. So what are the standards used for? Used for self-assessment and evaluation. And you communicate something that you follow in your healthcare facility, and that provides the basis for guidelines and standard procedure for other staff or new entrants. And you can also use it as an identification method for training teams. So overall, NABH has this 10 chapters and 100 standards. For small clinics, it's only 7 chapters and 63 standards. And clinics, it's different. So this is the overview of patient-centered standards and hospital-centered standards. And so basically, it revolves on these four mechanisms. One is the legal requirement. That is the requirement you need to practice in our country. Another one is the safety issue, providing a safe hospital premises, particularly with relation to air, water, waste, and electricity. And you have to monitor this services and develop certain indicators. So we call it the SMART indicators. Or quality indicators. And when you have a critical unit like operation theater, you have to monitor prevention and control of infection process. You have to maintain your medical as well as non-medical equipment, otherwise they will start giving trouble and provide safe premises for the elderly people. Particularly in our practice, more of elderly people, so you need to give them the safe premises, provide them with ramp and safety measures, and evaluate and rate your supplies. Suppose you are going to keep getting your supplies from many contractors and vendors, you definitely need this kind of evaluation and rating. So in patient-focused criteria, you have to involve the patient on decision-making, particularly when you are operating. Consent taking really becomes important nowadays, and get informed consent on specific aspect of treatment, particularly if you are going for secondary and tertiary procedures. Communicating with patients really helps, that actually gives a better relationship with patients and their families. Educating is very, very important. And you need to evolve certain quality criteria for all the services. If you are developing in your practice into a bigger one, outpatient services, the diagnostic services, medication, as well as OT management. And you also need to evolve some system to keep the medical records. As you develop your practice, this becomes very important because of the legal framework now. HR criteria is very, very important. As you develop your practice, staff planning and recruitment is really necessary, because at least 60% to 70% of the clinical work will be done by non-medical people and your helpers. So credentialing them during recruitment and verification is very, very important now. Staff development and training, particularly if you are going to develop a critical facility like theater, you have to rely on them for your infection control mechanism. So you need to train them, sit with them, train them, and also there has to be ongoing training mechanisms. You need to also monitor them, that's very, very important in clinical setup, and you also get their feedback. Not only patient feedback is important, you also need to get feedback from your staff. And so this is what people ask me when they want to go for accreditation. So what are their resources or how much money it would take? And basically the consultants would tell more staff, more equipment and more money. But as I have seen more than 80 to 90 healthcare institution accreditation, the requirements are very, very simple. You need time to work for accreditation. You need regular opportunity for interaction with your staff, not only consultants, your lower level staff. And you need data. So it's very, very important that you get data from the local staff as well as all the areas of your hospital. And that should be relevant. Thank you, Dad. You also need to get information, both academic and practical guidance on standards and measurements. So what are the resources for accreditation? For me, it's not only money, the skill for coordination, quality coordination, technical skills and training is more important than the monetary aspect. But more important is the attitude of the top manager. So if they are in this process, that the accreditation process becomes easier and smoother. So how to start? Again, it depends on the top management commitment. And so where to start? You need to start with the quality policy or mission statement. You have to address all the standard elements. You have to see to that your consultant. The main problem area in bigger hospitals is the consultant. You know, Rajiv will agree with me, and probably is not the junior staff. The junior staff are easy to handle. The senior management has to embrace the system and also see to that your consultant embrace the system. And so these are the quality objective. It has to be specific, it has to be measurable, and agreed, realistic, and time. These are smart indicators. So one common thing many hospitals now focus is reducing the waiting time by to the patient by 50%. So in ophthalmic hospital, it becomes really important. If you reduce 50% waiting time, at least 80% of the patients are really satisfied. So that's how you improve. So this is the basics of the entire system based on your records and documentation. Your format has to be standardized. Your instruction to the patient, the staff should be standardized. Procedures, not only your clinical procedures, but also non-clinical procedures should be standardized, and that becomes your manual. So basically, to achieve accreditation, you need to take it seriously, adopt and integrate all the standards required. It has to be part of your regular clinical life and way of life, and enforce accountability. It really helps in the business models also, to enforce accountability, educate, educate, and educate. So basically, as of now, accreditation is a voluntary initiative, but it might become mandatory, particularly the health minister is very fond of this. It has to be sustainable, and basically it has to be integrated into the daily work process. And so most of the medical, paramedical and stuff are appreciative of self-audit because it provides them training as well as professional development. And it is easy for the administrative heads to monitor because they get good data on quality monitoring. And it's also relevant in this era of insurance, medical tourism, and the medical-legal implications. So thank you so much, and thank you, Lakhmaji, for the opportunity.